if we get a drug for every disease and we put people on a cocktail of drugs when they're 70 years old so that they can live to 110 instead of 100, is that a good thing or not? The ethical or philosophical question is, are we living longer and healthier, or are we living longer and sicker?
Living well turns out to be about a lot more than just what you eat and how much you exercise. It's about survivorship. So we know, for example, that many people will now survive cancer therapy just to find that they're at a greater chance of heart attack and stroke. And so can we reduce that risk by doing new things? Research can give us the answers to that.
The pandemic has really taught us that the burning platform really leads to incredible acceleration of discovery. So this is equally applicable to other, what I call, burning platforms that have been burning for some time, such as the epidemic of diabetes around the world, chronic disease.
There are huge advances to be made in gene sequencing, personalised medicine, AI-assisted diagnosis, but these are expensive. I think we need to find economical ways to translate these benefits to the community at large and the world.
We often do the health kick, you know, often after New Year's, and then a couple of months down the track, we've gone off the rails or we haven't been able to maintain it.
We all do things that we know we probably shouldn't, with diet, with smoking, with exercise. Everybody knows what they should do. The question is, how do we help people to actually make it part of their lives? And that's very challenging. I think it's sociological as much as it is medical. Part of living longer and being more active for longer is you do get a sense that it's not going to happen to me, but it is going to happen to most of us, actually. So if you want to have that rich and active life for as long as possible, you need to do something about it now.
The pleasing thing that we know now is that there are many things that can be done, both in older age but also before older age, that can help you to age well and to have good health or better health in those later years. Things like good nutrition, good levels of exercise or physical activity, and this needs to start in childhood, get the right habits going.
Young people think they're immortal. We don't necessarily think about needing to prevent a disease when we're young. We don't consider the impact of the day-to-day decisions that we make, yet the cumulative effects of exposures such as high blood pressure or high cholesterol or diabetes can accumulate during those younger and middle-aged years and then lead to disease later on.
The ethics of ageing is a really interesting point, isn't it? As a drug discovery scientist, we are driven to try to treat those diseases and keep people alive for as long as we can, but it does raise the question of what's the balance between keeping people alive and keeping their quality of life at a level that it should be.
I don't think we should be putting all of our energy and all of our resources into anti-aging therapies, because what is inevitably going to happen is that people may wind up living longer but living sicker. Let's really put our efforts into uncovering novel information from studying aging, but then applying that to treating fatal and insidious diseases.
We're starting to show that the pathologies in Alzheimer's disease begin to accumulate over a period of 20 to 30 years. If somebody is diagnosed in their mid-70s, this disease is already starting in their mid-40s. As baby boomers move into their 60s and 70s, I think we are going to start to see a bit of a tsunami of dementia cases, and certainly that is going to be a big worry and a huge burden for the sort of healthcare system.
One of the areas that we've been getting involved in has been looking more broadly at the benefits of exercise for different subgroups of older people, and one of those is people with dementia. But the work that has been done in this space shows that exercise can help a range of different outcomes for people with early stages of dementia, but also can have some benefits in slowing down the dementia progress. And so this is an area that's only just starting to snowball, and it's not routine practice at the moment.
Preventing high blood pressure would be a game changer on the way that we live healthier for longer, because it is the underlying risk factor that leads to heart attacks, heart failure, stroke, kidney disease, and many others. Even these days, we know other diseases such as dementia, blindness, have a base on high blood pressure. My research focuses on high blood pressure and how we can leverage our gut microbes to lower blood pressure. What we did for our clinical trial was to give a new type of fiber that has been modified and enriched by these microbial substances directly. What we observed is that we're able to lower their blood pressure in as short as 3 weeks, which is quite remarkable and really exciting in terms of the future of prevention of cardiovascular disease.
We're still fighting a war against heart disease, but the outcomes have improved a lot, and we've seen a more than halving of mortality rates, and that's because of all of the advances in the way that we prevent, detect, and ultimately treat the disease. But it still remains the country's biggest killer. We need new drugs, we need new tests, we need new devices. Women are 3 times more likely to die of heart disease than breast cancer. That's a massive problem. So I have an incredible opportunity, and that is that I will open and direct the country's first heart hospital, the Victorian Heart Hospital. We're going to put this heart hospital on the university campus, and it really enables Monash, which already has a global reputation as a leader in heart disease and stroke, to take that to another level.
The technology that we have these days is just amazing, and I'm quite confident that we are going to find new ways to prevent cardiovascular disease and many other types of diseases in the next several decades to come.
We're thinking about where the next big advances are going to come from. It's hard to go past mRNA. The speed at which the vaccine emerged was amazingly rapid. Although it's one of those overnight sensations that was several decades in the making.
There's now an expectation by, you know, our young people in the community that this is the new normal, that we can accelerate discovery and bring that discovery to the clinic very quickly.
The reality is the ability to generate a preventative vaccine or a protective vaccine is a very different world than it is to generate the next cancer drug.
What's really interesting is these mRNA vaccines were originally studied for cancer prevention. So I think it's really exciting that now we have an application for a really terrible infectious disease, but now we'll be able to see potential off-target benefits for other conditions, such as melanoma.
The other area that I think is fantastic, or has the potential to be completely revolutionary, is in gene editing. This is an area that has already made enormous strides in drug discovery for many diseases that we're starting to recognise have got a genetic background to them. The ability to specifically go in and edit that gene and nothing else is remarkably powerful.
We've seen some ethical debate around some of the potential uses of it, but even in my own field, we're seeing new therapies entirely based on gene editing that we will now take into clinical trials. And so for the first time, very, very severe forms of cholesterol that have been essentially resistant to treatment with any of the drugs that we have may potentially be cured with one single treatment.
The next big breakthrough will be in the area of personalised medicine interacting with artificial intelligence and machine learning, and taking a patient's physiology or physiological response, feeding that information into a machine learning algorithm and coming up with a personalised plan to treat that person.
AI and data science has got a huge role to play in drug discovery. The big change is that it can make it quicker.
Over the past 2 years, what we saw with COVID was that if we really wanted to, there is a lot of funding that we can throw at solving a very big issue.
Funding and research is a really big challenge for us.
Researchers like me spend a lot of their time actually applying for funding.
If we do not invest into fundamental biology, then we will miss the opportunity to come up with blockbuster therapeutics.
We need to think, how are we going to be more successful in a competitive world, in a post-pandemic recovery? How are we going to find research dollars in a smart way?
Having access to philanthropy, to commercialisation, to venture capital, and also our government funding sources really allows us to be able to accelerate the work that we need to do. And that's really the challenge for us as a country, to be able to invest in what is the future for better care and better communities.